We're so glad to have all of you with us today at the Fowler Avenue Baptist Church. We're here to magnify the Lord Jesus Christ, elevate Him. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. So today we're here to elevate, magnify His precious name. We're so thankful that God so loved the world, He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. We thank God for our visitors coming in to be with us. We praise God for your presence. Thank God for the members and ones who are able to meet with us in the auditorium. So we're here, we'll be having people to testify and sing and give praise to the Lord. And the Bible says, this is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior, who will have all men to be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. There is but one God and one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus, who gave himself a ransom for all. So we're saying to those that are watching on video possibly, and you that are here in the auditorium, we thank God for you being here. We're here to magnify Christ. That day he died on that cross and shed his blood. The Bible says on the third day he rose again, conquering death, hell, and the grave. And so we're here to magnify Him, elevate Him. This is good, and accept the sight of God, our Savior, who will have all men to be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. God is not willing that any should perish. So God's love and grace goes out to all mankind, A-L-L. For God so loved the world, He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth should not perish, but have everlasting life. Well, the only way to have everlasting life and be able to go to heaven is by coming to Jesus Christ. It's not religion, it's not water baptism, not some pope or some preacher, but His name, the Lord Jesus Christ. You want to go down memory lane to the time and the place where you know that you know. You ask Christ to come into your heart and save you. The Bible says, there's none good, no, not one. There's none just. All our righteousness are as filthy rags. And so anytime someone tries to say, well, I'm going to heaven because I've been baptized, filthy rags. Baptism will not save you by immersion. We get baptized because we are saved. It's a testimony. And if you've received Christ as your Savior, you need to belong to a good local church somewhere. You need to follow Him in believer's baptism and haven't already. Not sprinkling on your head. That's not water. That's not Bible baptism. That's something concocted by some religious crowd. Putting water on your head or putting a little water on your babies. That is not baptism. Water baptism. The Bible says Jesus went down into the water. He came up out of the water. And so scripturally baptism is when you go down, get in that water, a picture of death and burial. When you come up out of the water, resurrection, newness of life. So if you're saved by the grace of God, we thank God that you're here today. We're magnifying the Lord Jesus Christ, elevating Him. Songs will be sung, testimonies will be given. And we thank God for that. So we're going to have let's have a word of prayer. Our Father, we come right now asking in Jesus' name that every one of us will search our heart. Go to the time and the place where we know we ask Christ to come into our heart and be our Savior. And Father, if some have not done that and they're doubting their salvation, may they drive a stake down today and renew their faith. Father, we just pray that you'll speak to our hearts. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Brother Gerald's going to come and lead us in a song. What song shall we sing, Gerald?
Storage of Tales of the Nations, page 296.
Let's all stand together if you're singing the song.
296. Thank you.
the nation that shall lift their hearts to the Lord. A song that shall conquer evil and scatter the spear and sword. And shatter the spear and sword.
Story will be my theme in glory. Call and then I'll fly. will rescue me, that you will set me free. I don't deserve your holy word, your precious love. Your love has transformed me, your love has set me free. I long each day for you to see. Rise up to me.
Well, praise the Lord. We had a great day yesterday. The weather was more like Florida weather, and so it brought out a lot of people. And I always pray for good weather because, you know, some people say you should pray for bad weather so it shuts down the event so they can't enjoy their time. But my desire is that a lot of people do come so that I have the opportunity to speak to them, amen. My concern is not what's going on, but that there's a lot of people that have, you know, come out. And so yesterday was a very good day. It was a long day, but there was so many people. It was just a river of people the whole entire day. And so the day goes fast because you're busy. You're speaking with people, you're preaching, you're handing out tracts. And so it's tiring. It wears me out. As the older I get, it gets harder and harder. But I thoroughly enjoyed myself yesterday at the Gasparilla Parade. Not because of the Gasparilla Parade, but because of the people and the amount of conversation. It's getting harder and harder to get conversation in America at a lot of these events. But yesterday, there was a lot of people that came up and they shared their heart. They had concerns about their own condition of drinking out there on the street. And just to have a young men, you know, 25, 30 years old, that will open up their heart and actually share their concern for their you know, falling into alcohol. And of course, from my age of 15 to 23, I was an alcoholic myself. And you shouldn't say an alcoholic, I was a drunk. And that's how I speak to people. And I had one guy, you know, he came up and he was a little, you know, he was trying to condone his drinking. And I was straight with him. I said, you know, you're a drunk. And he got upset, you know, and he's come back a little bit. And I said, yeah, but I'm here to tell you the truth. And I gave him my testimony and how I come to the Lord Jesus Christ and didn't have victory over alcohol or anything else in my life until I come to know Jesus Christ as my Savior. And, you know, he ended up thanking me. There was a couple of them. I had a couple of situations like that. But, you know, I appreciate your prayers for when we're out there because the prayers override that spiritual warfare that's going on. And we had a really great time out there. And I'd like to share a verse with you here because, you know, when we go out there and people, you always wonder, what should I preach to them? Yes, we're going to preach, you know, the gospel of Jesus Christ, but how? Because there are different ways to bring the gospel about and how to enter into their life or their realm of where they are. And yesterday, God impressed on me to preach of the love of God. The love of God, you know, look to the cross, it's a shame and humility and suffering of Jesus Christ beyond imaginable. But look at the cross and see the love, the fulfillment of the love of God on that cross and the obedience of Jesus Christ to the Father. He not his will, but thine will be done. And he suffered that. And look at the fulfillment of that love. And then look at the cross. Or the grave where the power of God was established. And when you can meditate on the love of God and the power of God out of that death, burial, and the resurrection, you can see that God can give you the power over your sin. Not just to forgive you of sin. I mean, God didn't come and bow down and say, hey, can I please die and pay for your sin? No, he didn't do that. He freely did it. He said, I'll freely lay down my life and I pick it up again. And but God did say that there's a free gift. And that free gift is that we need to believe in our heart that God raised up Jesus Christ from the dead. so that we have the full package of that. We're not only forgiven, but we have power through that resurrected Christ to say no to sin, amen, and to have victory over it. But there in Ephesians chapter 5 and verse 2, it says, walk in love as Christ also hath loved us and hath given himself for us an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet-smelling savor. And that was what God impressed on my heart to encourage people with yesterday. And you know, I don't normally, I usually preach a little harder than that, but you know, yesterday to see the effect of that, you know, to just say, you know, when people walk by and say, you know what, have you ever thought about God loves you? And just to see people kind of cringe back like, what, you know? And to really impress that point that God loved you more than you know. God loved you so much. And he said, there's no greater love than a man lay down his life for his friend. So God has looked to you as being a friend, and he laid down his life for you. And look at how wicked we are, and yet God went beyond his place of righteousness, and he set forth his Son, the mercy and the truth of God, to lay his life down for us. And it was just wonderful to be able to go out there and share the gospel. I enjoy that, being out in the middle of people, to be able to just lift up Jesus Christ to people and see him do a work. And we know it's all of him because it's his work. And so let's have a word of prayer. And remember, you know, one another in prayer, because the hurts and the sorrows that go on in life, we know that they're real. Doesn't matter if we're saved or unsaved. We live in a world where everything is just decays. It falls apart. It's the way of man is death. Amen. But we don't have to consider dying all the time. But we all have those problems. Amen. And so let's pray. Father God, we just lift up our prayers unto you, and we thank you for the avenue of prayer and that you have an ear for us. And you're sufficient for us in our time of trials and struggles. And Father God, I pray that you would touch each and every one that is facing trials and struggles, tribulations. And Father, that'd probably be each and every one of us. We need you in this day. And Father, we all have somebody on our heart that needs you in a spiritual way to know you as Savior. And or they may need you to know that you're the great physician, and or they may need to know that in the time of trial that you've never leave us nor forsake us. But Father God, we just pray that as we lift our prayers up to you this morning, that you would touch these people and let them know that you're real and that you're there. And Father God, I pray for those that are sick and that have a need of your hand upon them. I pray that you would give them comfort and that you would direct their hearts to you, Father, to just plead their case before you. And Father, we pray that as we go into this service, that you would open our hearts and our eyes up in a spiritual realm, that we might see the truth of your word, and that we might find help to serve you in a greater way in our life and to have overcoming the things in our life. And we give you all the glory and the praise in this day. And we do thank you in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Christian, let's stand on this, please. And then, Lisa. I'll tell the world that I'm a Christian. I'm not ashamed this name to bear. Tell the world how Jesus saved me and how he gave me a life renewed. And I know that if you trust him, that all he gave me, he'll give to you. I'll tell if his coming would be tomorrow or today. For when he comes and life is over, for those who love him, there's more to be. Eyes have never seen the wonder that he's preparing for you and me. Oh, tell the world that you're a Christian. Be not ashamed, this thing to bear. I'll tell the world that you're a Christian and take him with you everywhere.
Thankful for the people who minister to the boys and girls. We thank God for the parents and grandparents who bring their children. Paul reminded Timothy, from a child, technon, little child, his mother Lois or Eunice, from a child, he was taught the word of God. So we need to get the word of God into our lives, into our children's lives. And so it's very important, because the word of God affects every part of our being. And we need to understand that. And God so loved us, he gave his son to be our savior. How many of you got one of these outlines this Friday? Everybody get one? If you need one, raise your hand. We'll have one of our ushers to bring you one. If you need one of those, I want to share it with you. All right, raise your hands. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. This is real good. It's using your spiritual gifts. We find that everybody born physically have certain abilities and talents that it comes by the genes, your mother, your dad, and you're able to do certain things. But then when you're born again by the Spirit of God and become a Christian, then you have spiritual gifts that have been given to you also. And these are spiritual gifts that you need to understand. And we have 7 of them that are listed here in the outline that you have. It's about a mother. She's the people sitting around the table, and she drops pile on the floor. And then the people sitting around the table like you there, they begin to respond to that experience. Like, for example, the prophet spirit says, now notice what it says, that's what happens when you're not careful. A prophet spirit is when something happens, it comes out strong and forceful and not much. But then a serving, oh, let me help you clean it up, the motivation to fulfill a need. Teaching. The reason that fell is that it was too heavy on one side, or whoever dropped it slipped out of their hand. Exhortation. Next time, let's serve the dessert with a meal. Motivation to correct the future. Giving. I'll be happy to buy a new dessert to give a tangible need. Mercy. Don't feel badly. It could have happened to anyone. Motivation to relieve embarrassment. And then we have administration. Jim, would you get the mop? Sue, please help pick up. Mary, help me fix some other dessert. Achievement, immediate goals to the group. But that's the response. So these different, have a big church there. And so all the church members have certain spiritual gifts. Some have more than one, but we need to use them for the glory of God. We talk about giving back to God. God is a giver. God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. He went to Calvary, beaten with a cat of nine tails, rocks or metal on the end of it, and he was beat to a bloody pulp. Every time they would beat him with a lash and pull that back, it pulled his. He says, there's no beauty that we should behold of him. Here Jesus Christ is hung dying, bleeding, and shedding his blood because he loves you personally. For God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Would you like to go to heaven? Would you like to have eternal life? Then you must come to Jesus Christ. Receive him as your personal Savior. Do not leave this service today without knowing that I've asked Christ to come into my heart and save me. If there's doubts or questions, settle it today. Today is a day of salvation. There may not be a tomorrow, but we've got today. If your heart stops beating and the blood quits forcing for your aim, if you died right now, where would you go? You get in your car today, you drive, and all of a sudden, somebody runs into you, boom! You had not planned that. You may drop over with a heart attack. You may die with some physical disease. But sooner or later, you will slip out into eternity. And you want to make sure before that happens, there's no such thing as a purgatory where somebody can give enough prayers, enough money, and pray you out. That's a lie from hell. Listen, when you die, you're either going to heaven because you're saved by the grace of God, you've trusted Christ as your Savior, or you're going to hell. Heaven, if you're saved, a place that was prepared for the devil and his angels. Not for 100 years, not for 1,000 years, but forever and ever and ever, screaming and hollering. You remember that time? That rich man, he had everything. But we find that Lazarus had sat at his table, ate the crumbs that fell from his table, and both of them died. Lazarus went to heaven to be with the Lord. The rich man died, he had everything oral had to offer. He didn't have Jesus. We hear say that. Will someone please come and stick there in water to cool my mind? I'm tormented in this flame. I'm tormented. Can you imagine? No. No one can go to you after you left this place. You need to make that decision before you slip out into eternity. So I'll ask every one of you personally, where did you get saved? When did you get saved? Are you saved? If not, trust Jesus Christ today. We thank God for giving people. They give their time, they give their talents, their treasure back to God. I want to share you a few verses on giving. It says over in 2 Corinthians chapter 9, 6 and 8. Let me read this to you. But this I say, he which soweth sparingly shall reap also sparingly. He which soweth bountifully shall also reap bountifully. Every man according to a purpose in his heart, let him give. Not grudgingly or necessity, for God loves a cheerful giver. God loves a cheerful giver. He goes on to say this, and God is able to make all grace abound to you, that you always having all sufficiency in all things may abound to every good work. Remember the words of the Lord Jesus, who said, it is more blessed to give and receive. Over in Luke chapter 6:38, Jesus said, give, and it shall be given unto you. A good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over, shall men give into your bosom. For with what measure you meet, it shall be measured you again. That's the law of the harvest. What you give, it'll come back. And so it's so important that we serve the Lord Jesus Christ and be a giver. Over in Proverbs chapter 3, 9 and 10, honor the Lord with thy substance and with the first fruits of all thine increase. So shall thy barns be filled with plenty, and thy presses shall burst out with new wine. Over in Proverbs 11, 24, 25, there is he that scattereth and yet increaseth. There's he that withholdeth more than his meed. It tendeth poverty. The liberal soul shall be made fat, and he that waters shall be watered also. The law of the harvest is what you sow, you reap. What have you been giving to God? What have you been giving to him? I'd like to share a few thoughts about that thing. Before we give our service and substance to the Savior, we must be willing to give ourselves to him. A good example of this is found in 2 Corinthians chapter 8. The Bible says that those churches in Macedonia, Church of Philippi, Church of Thessalonica, while under great trial of affliction and deep poverty, joyfully they took part giving a special love gift to the poor saints in Jerusalem. Their example encouraged others to take part in grace giving. Grace giving. He goes on to say this. We call it faith promise giving. Grace giving provides your faith and the sincerity of your love. Grace giving provides a fellowship of spiritual working together and sharing. Grace giving, special fruit, special blessings to receivers and those who give. Give back to God your time, your talents, your treasure. You cannot outgive God. His shovel is bigger than yours. Give, and it shall be given to you. A good measure, pressed down, shaken, running over, shall men give you. Listen, be a giver. Give God your time. Give God your treasure. Give your talents and abilities, and God will give back to you. I want to listen to this song that will be sung right now. And Brother James asked him to look for the song. Thank you, Lord, for giving. Listen to this song, you'll love it.
You're not not supposed to cry, but I am almost sure there were tears in your eyes as Jesus took your hand and you stood before the Lord. He said, my child, look around you, for great is your reward. Thank you for giving to the Lord. For I am a life that was changed. Thank you for giving to the Lord. I am so glad you gave.
Thankful for each of you that have given your time, your talents, and treasure back to God. And God promises, given it shall be given to you. That's what Jesus said. May we learn to give back to God. Our time is in His hands. What time we have is in His hands. He gives us time, talents, and treasures that we give back to Him. He will multiply them. God will use what you give back to Him to reach the lost, doomed, damned, lost world. Give your time, give your talents, give your treasure back to God.